SpaceX does. SpaceX is actually kind of the best example of this. So that picture on the above right, what's up?
Speak up.
The picture on the above right kind of depicts the trajectory of the rocket as it goes through its maneuvers. And so you can see like the first half, it's kind of just like a normal rocket going up. And then at this point, the second stage separates, continues to orbit, lands a payload into space. Meanwhile, the first stage flips around and basically does this maneuver where it lands back on the landing pad. And that basically requires this boost back burn that cancels out its horizontal velocity and then basically tilts vertical. And it does this entry burn, and then it kind of glides down. And then does this last landing burn. This is kind of shown well by this video right here. Just a 30-second clip. So right now it's kind of horizontal with the Earth. And then it's kind of, it's burning its engine against its horizontal velocity. And then it does its entry burn, and then it lands on this drone ship. And the way it does that is basically with its engines that fire in retrograde.
Achieve here is to make Mars seem possible.
It's
something that we can do in our lifetimes.
You have to turn off the YouTube.
Elon finally told the world his vision for.
Basically, it does that with its grid fins to control its angle, and then its engines down here. So next slide. So this is basically my model from the top view. I have this multi-body part that's modeled as a cylinder. It has the same length, diameter, and density as an actual Falcon 9 booster. And I basically started off by basically only having it in the Z axis, so having it only basically falling down. And I basically only had to worry about burns and only that axis. And then as I got that working, I graduated to like the XZ plane, adding tilt and horizontal velocity initial points. So it's in general structures, I have this flight computer, which takes in data, velocity, angle, and position data from the booster core. It basically processes that information and sends it out to either the grid fins or the engines up here and here. And that basically puts forces and torques on this first stage and controls it back to this landing pad. Right. So in order to get the initial conditions, I found some data online. And this basically, this orange curve represents the velocity of the whole first stage trajectory from launch to landing. And the part that I'm interested in is really the part after the second stage detaches, which is modeled by when the velocity is in its valley right here. So I can assume that basically all vertical velocity is zero, canceled out at that point, and all the velocity I see here is in the horizontal direction, so that gave me my initial velocity of 293 meters per second. Also, the altitude was about 166 kilometers up vertically, and then the angle was at a negative 80. This is almost flat, not quite. Okay, so the main thing I was trying to simulate was the controls. I wasn't really concerned too much about getting the actual components working realistically, I should say. So I basically modeled this engine and broke down the thrust components into the XYZ components to basically make sure the thrust was going parallel to the rocket trajectory angle. And I basically had it set the max thrust is 900 kilonewtons, which is pretty accurate for a Merlin engine on a SpaceX rocket. And that's all modeled by this force vector in this expression here. And then I have three grid fins, and each one of those control the rocket and its XYZ rotations. And as I said earlier, I was only worried about the X, Z plane. So really I didn't need the X and the Z grid fins, but I found that they were pretty critical because what was happening is the rocket would like get off, tilt into that, or in those rotations by like 10 to the negative 13th, and once that happens, it just like started rotating and flipping all around. And I think that's just because of like the model and the tolerances were finite amount. The solver wasn't perfect. So basically I had these grid fins X and Z, which basically prevented it from going into those rotations. And the Y grid fin is basically the one that I was interested in controlling. I basically set it an angle, and that outputs a torque realistic to what is seen on the rocket. And it's modeled with this sinusoidal function here, which is pretty realistic, because if you think about it, like at zero angle, the air is just going right through, so there's really no torque exerted on the rocket. vertical is also, the arrow is just passing by it evenly, so there's also no torque, so max is like right at 45 degrees on either side. So moving on to the flight computer, this is like a big part of it. Basically I have all of my inputs, the position, the altitude, the ground position, and then all the rocket angle inputs. And I basically have a controller. I basically broke it down into a controller for each stage of the flight. So for example, these three controllers kind of happen in sequence, with the boost back controller taking over first. So this has a set thrust output, and it basically stops as soon as that horizontal velocity goes to zero. And that basically ends. And then at a certain point, the entry burn controller takes over, and that's just a time burn at a certain altitude. Then there's this landing controller. That's kind of a fancy one going on here, and that's a PD. But it's a little different in that the velocity and the altitude kind of controls so that they're proportionally come down to zero together. Because if you think about it, at the very end, you want the velocity, the vertical velocity to equal to zero, and you want the altitude to equal to zero. While a little bit above, like 100 meters up, you want the velocity to have a finite amount, and obviously the altitude a finite amount. This grid fin controller that's running constantly, while these are running one by one. And then this thrust vectoring decomposition, that's just basically breaking down the thrust so that the thrust accurately depicts where the engine is directing it. All right, then I have the grid fin controller. So that was the subsystem you saw here. Just breaking it down just a little bit. And then it basically serves three functions. It's basically preventing the rotation of the rocket while it's thrust vectoring. Otherwise, like if you think of like inverted pendulum, if you exert a force on the bottom, it'll just like start flipping out of control. So you really need those to prevent that. And you also need the fins to allow it to go from horizontal to vertical upright orientation. And lastly, you need the grid fins to basically guide the rocket over to its landing pad. And that's basically all done with this logic. Basically have a ramp function that you can see down here, and that's the overall kind of orientation of the rocket. So you can see down here, it pretty closely follows that. And red is the actual grid fin angle. Yeah, and then on top of that, I have this location controller, and that's basically another PD controller that basically guides the rocket to its landing zone. So that basically adds a small amount on top of this ramp function to basically guide it back to its landing zone. And you can see this blue curve down here, that's the horizontal position. So you can see the boost back burn that happens between 0 and 60 seconds, that nearly cancels it out. And then the location controller basically kind of takes over and guides it back to about 10 to the negative, 10 to the 4th. So it does a good job of guiding it to the landing pad. And then, kind of wrap things up, I got the landing simulation. The initial conditions that I found, I modeled here in the middle, and that basically shows the horizontal trajectory on the bottom axis and the vertical component altitude on the vertical axis. They can show the rocket trajectory as it moves across. And you can see that if all goes well, it basically looks like this animation down here where it lands on a pad. And this is when I gave it a little more horizontal velocity, about 300 meters per second, so it kind of overshoots it, but the location grid fin controller basically guides it back to its landing pad. And that was about the limit on the upper end of the initial velocity. On the lower end, I found it to be about 250 meters per second, so that really undershot. And then it's really, the grid fin's really pulling the whole rocket over to the right. And then lastly, I was really trying to compare this to actual SpaceX data. So red is their altitude data as the booster falls back to Earth. And blue is my trajectory. So you can see they follow each other pretty closely. And the only difference, I think, is caused by some failures in not modeling the air density correctly. I don't know. And then also map out like the different like maneuvers that it undergoes throughout its trajectory. That's all I got.
Did you have fun?
Yeah, it's good.